All right, so moving forward, I would like to introduce our next speaker, who is founder and CEO of Mandate Molefi Human Resources Consultant. She has been mentioned in the Global Talent Competitive Index 2018 report as an example of an international thought leader on diversity and inclusion. She also has authored various books on the topic. She is also actively involved in Meals on Wheels SA, and she sits on the advisory structure of the Auditor General of SA. We welcome you, Ms. Nene Molefi, and I would like to hand over the mic to you. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for the introduction. And for me here, it's like good day from South Africa. I would like to share my slide because I'm going to be talking from my slide. So the topic that I'll be addressing is bridging the polarity of diverse perspectives. And this is an important topic because whenever you deal with diversity and inclusion, there's so much differences with regards to perspectives that are there. So what do we mean by polarities? Polarities lead to polarization. And I like the quote there by Barry Johnson, sorry it has cut, where he says there is a distinction worth making between a problem you can, which is a polarity that you need to manage. So a polarity needs to be managed on an ongoing basis. So this dilemma that contains seemingly opposing ideas, and it's often presented as adversarial. Examples of dilemmas or polarities is like liberal versus conservative, future orientation versus past orientation. Whenever I run my diversity and inclusion workshops, I sometimes hear people say, forget the past, we're moving to the future. Just forget everything that happened to women or to Black people or whatever different groupings, just move forward. So other people tend to look at this from a future orientation and others say, no, we cannot forget the past. And they're both not wrong. They're just polarities that we need to manage. Or now during times of COVID, I'm sure you'd agree with me, there's argument between lives or livelihood. And here in my country, there's a constant debate that the lockdown is strangling the economy. And then the health professionals are saying, but look at the numbers, the COVID numbers. So do you think you value life more than you value the economy? It's not either or. So every time we get confronted with these polarities, we need to see polarities as complementary and interdependent and find ways in which, especially in the space of diversity and inclusion, how we can manage that. If we focus on one and neglect or exclude the other, the resultant effect will cause us, and it always happens, the resultant effect will actually cause us to neglect and to move in cycle all the time because we are not getting to a point where we can balance these. So, and I'm sure you'd agree with me that most of the time polarities we are working towards the same goal. I don't think there is anyone on this platform, whether you are a parent, you are a sibling, you are a colleague, we all want the best for our children or for future generations. So whether you fall within the privileged or the ones that are not privileged, all of us are actually looking for the same thing. So if we can define this common future that we're working towards, it will make it very easy for us to work through these polarities. So if you look also as why my topic was around bridging polarities, why is it important to bridge polarities? So think about it. If we are to see a future where power and privilege coexist with social justice, not as opposing poles, but instead codependencies, we would make progress towards social cohesion because societies need social cohesion where you don't get people who are marginalized, people who are excluded. But if we can say in instances where I have power, where I have privilege, how can I use that in order for me to fight for social justice? The negative impact of polarization on our ability to address disparities at both a personal, institutional and structural basis are visible because we have been unable to balance these polarities And you can see how visible these are with the challenges that we are having on an ongoing basis globally in our country, in our world. I like the quote by Martin Luther King Jr. where he says, "Our lives are inextricably connected. Injustice everywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. We are caught in this inescapable network of mutuality, tied in a single garment of destiny." It links to what I said earlier, that actually we want a common goal. Whatever affects one directly affects all indirectly. Just take the Black Lives Matter that we've seen with the George Floyd thing in the US. And you don't have to have physically been in the US, but you can see how the interconnectedness, that the impact that it had all around the world. So we are actually connected, as Martin Luther King says, Jr. How can we bridge these polarities? What is it that we can do on our own to bridge these polarities that exist? One of our leaders here in South Africa, Bishop Tutu, likes his quote. He says, "If you are neutral in situations of injustice, you have chosen the side of the oppressor. If an elephant has its foot on the tail of a mouse, and you say you are neutral, the mouse will not appreciate your neutrality." So if you are saying, okay, we have these polarities, people looking at our lives from their point of view, their worldview. So we are calling on allies, we are calling on upstanders, because silence is complicity. In fact, it's complicity. It can even be worse. It can be encouraging people who are oppressing others. Hence, when you look at this quote, I like the fact that he uses the elephant and the mouse to say the mouse will not appreciate your silence in this instance. So how can we bridge? One, I've got two tips or suggestions. One, we can be allies. A nice definition of allyship that I like is that where privilege meets oppression in a journey of change. That allyship, working together, where privilege meets oppression on a journey of change. That's what you can call, there are many other definitions, but I like this one. And also, what's also important as we talk about this, how not to be a toxic ally. Because other people have good intentions. You can be an ally. Let's say you are an ally for LGBTQ, and then the way you show up as an ally is like, you probably need coaching. So allyship is not about taking over. Allyship is walking beside and walking along. It's not about the personal agenda or climbing on the bandwagon. It is staying the course as opposed to jumping out as soon as it's uncomfortable. You sometimes hear comments like, you know, I tried to help them and look at how they hurt me. Allyship is difficult. It's not an easy course. So the desire for change should be greater than the fear. Because along the way, there's going to be personal sacrifice if I choose to be an ally for, let's say, a marginalized group that I might not be part of. So allyship is messy. Social justice is messy because it's about rectifying the wrongs. I'm sure you'd agree with this, that it's difficult for people with power and privilege to give it away. And I'm saying give it away in inverted commas, because it's not so much of give it away. It's about bridging the polarities that I spoke about. So the reasons for allyship is that we can be better together, we can be stronger together, that change comes when we are accountable to each other. If we work together, if you think of this common future that I spoke about, that in this world, all of us have a right to live in this world, both oppressors and the oppressed, we all have a right to live. It's about how we recontract on designing that life that we can live together. So that is allyship. The second tip that I have around how can we help bridge these polarities is, if we can all use what I call, use your rank, your power and privilege to bridge these polarities. What do I mean by rank, power, and privilege? In society, all societies, people are ranked in a social strata. You know, in sociology, they were teaching us that the social strata, people are ranked, that if you show, in my country, if you show up as white, as male, even before you open your mouth, the assumption is that you know better than somebody who looks like me. If you are male, whether black or white, if you are male, is that you would have better rank than power that society bestows on you, even before you say a thing. So there's certain things that are bestowed on us by virtue of who we are, how we were born. Therefore, if I find myself having power and rank and privilege, how can I help to bridge is to use that which I already have to say, how can I reach out and help others? For example, I just wanted to use myself as an example. If I were to identify areas of my rank and power and privilege, and what does rank power mean is that when the culture is normative around you, that you have the privilege. Here I am black, I am a woman, so those two in my country, I have less power, I have less privilege because of that. But these that are in black, you know what? I'm an employer. I own a company. I'm a CEO. I am cisgender. I was born, you know, the gender that I am, and I was born with the sexual the sex that matches the gender that I show up as. And heterosexual. I'm heterosexual. Why is it having power and privilege? Is that people who are not heterosexual in my country and many other countries are marginalized. I am able-bodied. If you look at me and take a woman who's born exactly in the place that I was born in Soweto, and let's say for she was born and she's in a wheelchair, and I'm like this, I already have power and privilege. Even before we open our mouths, people automatically, especially in the corporate world, automatically elevate me. My level of intelligence could have nothing to do with it just because I'm able-bodied. In my country, Christians, for people who are not Christian, for example, is like some of them are marginalized, relatively middle class. I'm educated. So there are instances, even when I'm disadvantaged, there are instances where I have power, where I have privilege. So what is it that I can do with the power and the privilege that I have to make someone else's life easier? To then jump and go to what I call allyship. I can be an ally. For people who are not experiencing life the way that I'm experiencing, just because I was born able-bodied. I'm just using that one as an example. So, and I'll rather leave the other topic for us to ask the questions. So in all that we're doing, two things: use your rank, your power, your privilege. Number two, decide to be an ally and walk the path of an ally. Educate yourself around what does it mean to be an ally? What does it mean to not be a toxic ally? In that whole journey, there is a need to also take care of ourselves. Fill your cup, because work, this is 22 years that I've been working in diversity and inclusion. And I can tell you, this work can lead to fatigue. It can lead to emotional draining. You can come home and feel that I've been in a session where the dialogue was such that there was such negativity, and that it can drain you emotionally. So all of us have to have our own personal practices to take care of ourselves. I practice these three interchangeably: prayer, journaling, and meditation. And I find that if I don't fill my cup in this way, I show up there as a facilitator of diversity and inclusion with my baggage. Because sometimes you'll be facilitating a workshop, somebody says something about your culture or about your race group or about your gender that presses your buttons. So if you don't take time to fill your cup, if you don't take time to say, who is my heart keeper? I always say, as consultants or facilitators employed in organizations, we need to find who our heart keepers are so that we can share and debrief. This work can be very demanding, and therefore we need to take care of ourselves while we are activists for ensuring that the social cohesion, we have a diverse, equitable, and inclusive society as we are all aiming to have. Thank you. Let me stop here and rather check if there are questions. I was just scared to go beyond my time. So
thank you so much, Ms. Mene Mulepi, for that insightful talk. The way you said that it's very important to just pause and see who is your heart keeper and fill your cup. That was really very important part of everyone's life. So moving on to question and answers. Audience, if you have any questions, please post it in the box below. We have 2 minutes to answer a question, so we can have your questions in the box. Please be ready with your questions. Or you can just post in the question and answer box. We can pass them on to the speaker. So, Ms. Nene Mulepi, we have no questions at the moment. Thank you so much for joining in and sharing your valuable time. Really nice of you to come here.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.